During the time of Christ, a talent was a measure of silver currency, and a single talent weighed about 80 pounds, or about 6,000 denarii, the currency of the day. 6,000 denarii was roughly the value of 20 years of work by a single ordinary person. At today's median wage, a single talent would be worth over $500,000. The story of the talents goes like this. A businessman went on a journey. Before he left, he called his workers together and divided his money between them. To the first worker, he gave 5 talents of gold. To the second worker, he gave 2 talents. And to the third worker, he gave 1 talent. Then he left on his journey. The first worker who received 5 talents of gold went at once and invested the money, doubling his money. The second worker also used the money wisely and doubled his 2 talents of gold into 4. But the worker who had received 1 talent of gold went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid the money. The businessman returned from his trip and settled accounts with his workers. He was delighted with the profits that the first 2 workers returned, praising them and promoting them. Then the worker with the single talent of gold reported in. "I was frightened of losing your money, and so I hid the gold. See, every coin is safe." Enraged, the businessman said, "You are a lazy worker. I gave you the money to use and grow my business. You could at least have put money in the bank so I could have earned interest. Now your money will be taken away and given to the first worker. You're fired. Leave the premises at once."
I just love his voice, don't you? That was Stuart Briscoe, Pete's dad. He graciously did those for us. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, thank you so much for this opportunity to hear from your word, to hear from your teaching, Jesus, about some truths that really do apply to our lives every day. And so thank you that you love us enough to let your teaching seep into our hearts. I pray that you, by your Spirit, would speak through me, that you would open up our eyes and our ears and our hearts so that we might respond to your truth, to your Spirit's promptings. And we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you please turn in your Bibles, if you have them, to Matthew 25. Matthew is the first of the Gospels. It's the first book of the New Testament. If the Bible is fairly new to you, it's about 2/3 of the way into your Bible. And so while you're turning to that, I want to tell you a little bit of a story about when I was 9 years old. I know we have a lot of kids in the room today. We are having the kids with us in the big room for the next 4 weeks. And so kids, we're so glad that you're here. And I hope that you guys learned something that will really apply to you as well today. But when I was 9 years old, I had a birthday party. And I decided to do it in a skating rink because I loved hockey at the time. I was a big Chicago Blackhawks fan. And hockey was really big back then in the mid-70s. And so I dreamed of being a hockey player. There was only one problem. I couldn't skate really very well at all. And so I bought some hockey skates, thinking that that was really the issue. It was just that I didn't have, I had figure skates and not hockey skates when I went and rented them at the ice rink, and that didn't work. So I could skate really fast, but I couldn't stop. And I couldn't skate backwards. And I probably went every week for about 6 weeks before my birthday party thinking, you know, when I get to my birthday party, I'm going to be better and I'm going to be able to skate really well. So it kind of worked out. I skated okay. I almost got to where I could skate backwards, but, you know, so the day came to my birthday party, and I had about 15 guys that came from my class, and this one guy in particular, I don't know what his name was because I probably blocked it out. It was a bad memory for me. Anyway, he came to me, and he said, "I'm really nervous about skating. I've never skated in my life. I'm afraid I'm going to hurt myself and fall." I just said, "Hey, don't worry about it. All of us fall initially. It'll really be okay. Believe me. You know, it's taken me 6 weeks to get as good as I am right now," which was not very good. And wouldn't you know it, he puts on his skates, he gets out there, and zip, 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 zip. He's skating backwards. He's doing triple axels. I mean, the guy's just incredibly good naturally at what he does, right? He was a born skater. Some of us are naturals at certain things. All of us are a natural at something. All of us are good. God has given us talents and abilities. For me, it wasn't skating. For me, it was singing. From the time that I was 4 years old, I knew that I could sing. My mom was the piano player at our church, and she knew that I could sing, and she discovered it. And every time we had a party at our house, she would trot me out and make me sing carpenter songs and all sorts of other crazy stuff. That's dating me, isn't it? I know. So great, Mom. I can sing like a girl. That's great. Thank you for that. No, but it was wonderful. She was very proud of me, and it was evident early on that that was how God had naturally gifted me. And so it was a raw gift, and it was something later on I would need to develop, but I discovered what I was good at. All of us have natural gifts. All of us, if we're in Christ or in the kingdom, remember we're talking about once upon a kingdom. We're talking about the kingdom of God, which is mostly what Jesus was talking about when he told his parables. If you are in Christ, which means if you have said yes to Jesus, if you have given him your heart and your life and asked him to come in and be your Savior and your forgiver, if you have done that, you are in Christ. You are in the kingdom. If you are, we know scripturally that there are things that you are not only naturally good at, but things that you are supernaturally good at, things that God gives you the ability to do supernaturally when you become a Christian. We call them spiritual gifts. Now, we can choose to develop and multiply those gifts, or we can squander them. We can put them in the ground like that wicked servant that Stuart talked about. We can choose to use them for the benefit of the kingdom. We're a part of the kingdom. Or we can look after our own interests. We can use them only for our own gain or our own good. The tension that we face when we really think about this is we may not even know what we're good at. Some of you might not have discovered that yet. Some of you may and realize that, you know what, I'm not getting any better. I'm just kind of content to stay where I'm at. And some of us are only using what we're gifted at for our own gain, for our own business or for our own purposes, and not really a part of the kingdom. Well, the good news is that Jesus had a lot to say about this. The parable of the talents, which we're going to read in just a second, is usually taught in Sunday school and from the pulpit as if Jesus was giving an object lesson. He was teaching a lesson about how to live. That's not what he was doing. It's not what he was doing at all. He didn't have a group of kids around him, which he from time to time did, and he would teach them. But in this case, that's not what was happening. So the problem with viewing it this way is sometimes it might sound, if you read the parable this way, that Jesus was just telling us how to live, as if Jesus was saying to you, you have gifts. If you develop them, God's happy with you and will bless you. If you have gifts and you don't develop them, then he will send you away. And it sounds like his acceptance of you is on the basis of what you do. And friends, that is just simply not true. It's not consistent with the rest of Scripture. And kids, I want to say to you, and big kids as well, God loves you exactly the way that you are. His acceptance of you, his salvation, is based not on what you do, but on what Jesus has already done. He loves and accepts and fully embraces you on the basis of the fact that Jesus loved you and died for you. And if you said yes to him, if you're a part of the kingdom, then you are completely accepted and you have everything that you need. That's the truth. So what was Jesus saying? Well, you have to understand the context of it. First of all, he had just entered his triumphal entry. It was the last week of his life. It was just after Palm Sunday. Remember Palm Sunday when he had the people were waving the palm branches and Jesus came in on a donkey? And when he did that, he was proclaiming that he was the Messiah. He was saying, okay, you've kind of heard whispers and rumors about it, but that is who I am. Because all of the religious leaders would have known when he rode in on that donkey, that's what he was claiming. And so he had just had a couple of days of really sparring with the religious leaders. See, Jesus was angry with the religious leaders of the day because God had entrusted the care of the Jewish people to these religious leaders, and they had done a poor job of it. They were the poor steward in the story. That's who Jesus was talking about. See, he got in their face and he said, God gave you these people to love and to point to him, and instead you have kind of padded your own wallets and you have told them to live one way, but you actually live another. And he challenged them and he said, it's not okay. You are not a part of the kingdom, because if you were, you would live differently. And so that was the context of it. He left the temple. He was going to the Mount of Olives, which is about a half-hour walk outside of Jerusalem. It's a hill that overlooks Jerusalem. And along the way, the disciples were saying, they were trying to change the subject. And they were saying, hey, Jesus, look at the temple. Isn't that a cool building? And Jesus was like, having none of it. And he basically said, you need to know that every single stone of that temple will be torn down. It's going to be destroyed. He was talking about the last days. And so they started asking him about him. They didn't really understand that. And he started telling stories to them. He told them about what the kingdom will be like someday. Remember last week, Pete said, the kingdom of God is already, but not yet. Already, but not yet. What he means by that is that Jesus is describing the reality of what the kingdom will be when he has ultimate kingship over all the earth. Okay, so the people in the story are, there's the religious leaders who he equates with that first servant, or that last servant, the lazy servant that dug the hole in the ground and stuck the talent there. And the people in the kingdom, what is normal kingdom life, are the first two servants that he talks about. Let's read this together, Matthew 25, starting with verse 14. So here's the story. For it, what is it? If you look back to verse 1, it talks about the kingdom. Okay, it says, at that time, the kingdom of heaven will be like. When Jesus comes into his full kingship and lordship, when the kingdom is firmly, finally established, this is what it will look like. For it, the kingdom, is just like the man, like a man about to go on a journey, who called his own slaves and entrusted his possessions to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and another 1, each according to his own ability. And he went on his journey. Immediately the one who had received the 5 talents went and traded with them and gained 5 more talents. He took the gifts God gave him and he multiplied them. In the same manner, the one who had received the 2 talents gained 2 more. But he who received the 1 talent went away and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. Now after a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. The one who had received the 5 talents came up and brought 5 more talents, saying, Master, you entrusted 5 talents to me. See, I have gained 5 more talents. His master said to him, Well done, good and faithful slave. You were faithful with a few things. Now I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. Also, the one who had received the 2 talents came up and said, Master, you entrusted 2 talents to me. See, I have gained 2 more talents. His master said to him, Well done, good and faithful slave. You were faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. And the one also who had received the 1 talent came up and said, Master, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you scattered no seed. And I was afraid and went away and hid your talent in the ground. See, you have what is yours. But his master answered and said to him, You wicked, lazy slave, you know that I reap where I did not sow and gather where I scattered no seed. Then you ought to have put my money in the bank, and on my arrival I would have received my money back with interest. Therefore, take away the talent from him and give it to the one who has the 10 talents. For to everyone who has, people in the kingdom, more shall be given, and he will have an abundance. For from the one who does not have, even what he does not have shall be taken away. Throw out the worthless slave into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And again, that last servant, he is directly referring to the religious leaders and the unfaithfulness of their service to him. Okay, so here's a couple of things that we can learn from this. And I'm going to point to some other scripture as well. If you want to turn to the next one, it's John 15. We'll get there in a second. But I want to point out a few things that I think this parable teaches us. First of all, everything is God's. Everything is God's. Everything you have belongs to God. That is a kingdom perspective, friends. We think that we acquire wealth on our own, that out of our own gifts and our own abilities, we acquire things and we get position and we have homes and cars and, you know, influence. But friend, everything that we have is God's, and he is entrusting us to it, to steward, to manage, to develop until he comes. Secondly, he entrusts us with his resources. He entrusts his resources to us. He graciously includes us in the kingdom business. That was what was happening in this story. So there was a guy who owned a lot of things, and he entrusted it to some people. He could have handled it himself, right? But he chose to involve other people in his business. And that's what God does. He graciously includes us in his kingdom business, in the adventure of building the kingdom. And here's the next thing, and this is the main point. If you write nothing else down today, write this down. This is the point of the sermon. Kingdom people glorify God, they give worship to God, by growing and using their gifts for the kingdom. Let me say that again. Kingdom people glorify God by growing, developing, and using their gifts for the kingdom. And there's four aspects here that I want to point to. Of kingdom people. See, I think what Jesus is doing in this parable is he's saying there's people outside of the kingdom that don't know me, that don't serve me, that haven't trusted me, that won't accept me as the Messiah. The religious leaders are the best example of that. And he says, then there are people who have received me and trusted in me and are a part of the kingdom, a part of my family. Here's what kingdom people are like. Kingdom people are faithful. They're faithful. It's one of the defining characteristics of someone who is in the kingdom. What did he say to the two servants, the first two servants? Well done, good and faithful servant. That's our desire. That's the desire of every person who is in Christ to hear those words from Jesus one day. Well done. You have done a great job with what I've entrusted you with. Well done. But that is something, faithfulness. It's not something we can produce on our own. It's something that the Spirit of God does in us. See, if you are in Christ, it means the Spirit of God, that Jesus literally lives inside of you in the person of the Holy Spirit. Kids, have you ever heard, ask Jesus into your heart? What we mean by that is when you trust in Jesus for your salvation, you will go to heaven one day. But not only that, Jesus comes to live in your heart by the Holy Spirit. So if you believe in Jesus, if you've trusted him, then he lives in your heart. And what he will do is if you learn to depend on him and him alone, and we call that surrender, he will begin to have character qualities that are just like Jesus come out of your life. So you will begin to look like Jesus. And one of those things is faithfulness. Faithfulness, being true to what you say you will do, doing what you say you will do. That's faithfulness, being faithful with God has given you. The second thing is kingdom people are fruitful. They're faithful and they're fruitful. He makes things happen through them. It's a natural result of living in Christ. If you are in Christ, if you are connected with him vitally, if you are living in surrender, then things are going to pour out of your life and he's going to bear fruit. He's going to create things that happen out of your life. Let's go back to John, or over to John now. I told you to turn to John 15. This is starting with verse 5. Jesus said, "I am the vine, you are the branches." Right? That's the grapevine or the olive tree. I am the vine, you are the branches. The life is in the vine. If you remain in me, if you stay connected to me, is what he's saying, and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Who's producing the fruit? Jesus, right? Not you. You are the branch. He gives you the life. He produces the fruit through you. If you remain in me, and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, cut off from me, you can do nothing. If you do not remain in me, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. See, there's the consistency of the imagery there. It's exactly what he said about the wicked servant, right? About what he's saying about those chief priests and Pharisees and Sadducees who will not trust in Jesus. They are disconnected from God because they have rejected Jesus. And as a result, there is a consequence to that. They will be tossed aside. That's what he's saying here as well. But if you remain in me, if you stay connected with me, and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. Listen to this. Verse 8, I love this. This is to my Father's glory. This is worship, he says, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be disciples. It's an evidence that you are kingdom people if you're bearing fruit. See, kingdom people are fruitful. The next thing is, kingdom people are about the things of the kingdom. Don't turn to this right now, but 1 Corinthians 12, 4 through 7, you can write that reference down if you want to. It says this, there are different kinds of gifts. He's talking about spiritual gifts. Remember, we said that there are things you're naturally good at, there's skills and talents you have, and then there's things you are supernaturally good at. Those are spiritual gifts. There are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit distributes them. There are different kinds of service, different things to do in the church, but the same Lord. There are different kinds of working, but in all of them and in everyone, it is the same God at work. Who is at work? God. God is at work through you. There's that through line all the way through here. Now, to each one, the manifestation of the Spirit or the gift of the Spirit is given for a reason, for the common good. For the common good. See, kingdom people are about the things of the kingdom. They are about the good of things of the kingdom. So the principle here is to say, if you have a spiritual gift, God gave it to you for a reason. If you have a natural ability, God gave it to you for a reason. And the reason is that he wants to use it for the good of the kingdom, for the building up of the church, and then for the mission of the church going out from this place. He gave you the gift that you have for a reason. It's not just to build a business. It's not just to get yourself to take care of your family. Those are all good things, and those are all things that God allows us to do. But the primary reason he gifted you and made you the way that you are is for the good of the kingdom. He has a purpose for those things in your life. Kingdom people, this is the fourth thing. Kingdom people take what God gives them, and they multiply it. They develop it. 1 Timothy 4:14. Through 16 says this, and this is Paul writing to his protege. So a protege is somebody that you're kind of raising up to do what you do, and that's what Paul was doing with Timothy. He was a young pastor. He had a teaching gift which was given to him by the Spirit. It was a spiritual gift. It wasn't a natural gift. It was a spiritual gift that came upon Timothy when the elders of the church prayed for him and laid hands on him, and the Holy Spirit came and gifted him with the gift of teaching. And this is what Paul says to Timothy. Do not neglect your gift. Don't dig a hole and put it in the ground. Don't just sit on it. Don't neglect your gift, which was given you through prophecy when the body of elders laid their hands on you. Be diligent in these matters. What it means is work hard, okay? Pay attention to your teaching. Practice it. Do well with it. Be diligent in these matters. Give yourself wholly to them so that everyone may see your progress. Watch your life and doctrine closely. Persevere in them because if you do, here's the kingdom purpose, you will save both yourself and your hearers. What he's saying to Timothy is he's saying, you have been given a gift, but it's a raw gift. It needs to be developed. You need to practice it. You need to study it. You need to look at other teachers. And whatever it is that's your gift, God would say the same thing to you. I gave it to you for a purpose and a reason, but it's a raw gift. It needs to be developed. That's your part in it. My part was to give you the gift and give you the opportunity to use it. Your part is to develop it and work on it and get better at what you do. Why? Because he has a kingdom purpose for it. It's kind of like a pen. You know, wouldn't it be great if you had a pen that every time you use it, you put it down in the drawer, and while you were not using it, it was working on making itself better, right? So every time you picked it out of the drawer, when you went to use it, you're like, oh my gosh, it writes in like six colors now. It's amazing, you know? That's what happens. You can be a tool in the hand of God for the building of the kingdom. And when you develop your gift to the point that everyone around you sees it, even the average Joe can look at what you already do and say, wow, you've grown. That honors God. It glorifies God. And then it is useful for him in the building of the kingdom. So I told you that when I was singing, it was an undeveloped gift. And here's what I mean by that. I would sing, and I had a nice voice, but there was only a kind of a lid on my range. I couldn't sing above a certain note. And it was really frustrating to me. And I used to hang around my room and listen to the band Kansas. I would listen to different bands, different albums when I was studying, and my favorite one was Kansas. And my favorite song of theirs was a song called Carry On Wayward Son, which is just a really cool song. And I just couldn't sing it. It was just stinking high, all right? The guy who sang that, Steve Walsh, was a mutant. Men should not be able to sing that high. All right, Steve Perry from Journey and the guy from Aerosmith. It was the same thing. I grew up with those songs, and I could not sing way up that high, and it was so frustrating to me. And I got into ministry when I was about 23, and I was singing rock songs for a youth group, and I couldn't sing very high, and I would sing something really high one time in our performance or our program, and then I had no voice when I went home, and I was so frustrated. And so what did I do? I wanted to be more useful in the kingdom. I wanted to be a good steward of the gift God had given me. So I went to a voice teacher, a friend of mine recommended. And he listened to me for the first time. He said, I like your voice. He said, but I'm writing a book and I'd like to put you in it. Okay. He said, why is that? He said, because there are seven types of tension all throughout your body that negatively affect your voice that we know of. You're the only person I've ever seen that sings with all seven at the same time. It's like I had a brick in my throat. And he said, that's why you can't sing those notes, because you're like locked up. He said, trust me, I'm going to give you some exercises. I'm going to work with you. You will unlock your voice, and eventually you'll be able to sing all the notes that you wanted to. I didn't believe him at first, but I decided to trust him. I did the work, and lo and behold, after about a year or 2 years, believe me, my problems were severe, so I really had to work hard to get over them. People at church would come up to me and said, you're singing so much better. Which I kind of took two ways. Like, was I really that bad before? No, but what they were saying is what Paul's saying here in his letter to Timothy. Your progress in growing your gifts should be so obvious to everyone that everyone, even the average Joe who doesn't really know what it is that you do, they can just tell that you're getting better, that you're getting better. It gives glory to God. Remember, kingdom people glorify God by growing and then using their gifts for the kingdom. Okay, so I want to have you do a quick exercise here, and you don't need to do it now, but just write these questions down if you would. I'm going to give you five questions. Before I give you those five questions, I'm going to ask you one more question. The most important question is, are you in the kingdom? Are you in the kingdom? Have you ever trusted Jesus with your whole life? Have you trusted what he did on the cross for your salvation? See, you have a problem. It's called a sin problem. All of us do before we trust Christ. They're bad choices. Sin is just another word for bad choices, kids. So have you made bad choices? All of us have. And Jesus said that's a problem because God is perfect and holy, and he can't have things that aren't perfect and holy in his presence. And he loves you so much that he wants you to be with him forever. So he worked it out. You're not perfect. He is. You can't be together. What do? He sent Jesus to live a perfect life and then to die on the cross, which is what imperfect people deserve, is death. And he said, I'm going to take that penalty. I'm going to die, and then I'm going to give you my life. It's a trade. It's a great trade. Take it, okay? So my question to you is, have you taken that trade? Have you given him your sin and taken on his righteousness on the basis of what he did on the cross? If you have said yes to Jesus and invited him into your heart to be the Lord and the leader of your life, then you are in the kingdom. Have you done that? If you haven't, do it today. Okay, then here's the five questions. Five questions I want you to ask yourself and answer are, what am I naturally good at? What are your skills and abilities? And I said this first hour, and my seven-year-old Avery made her list. And as you can tell, humility is one of the top, no. She's good at, I love this. I love that she knows herself. She's good at soccer, swimming, piano, singing, art, gymnastics. She's kind. She's thoughtful. She's awesome. I love that. And she is. So make your own list. What are the things that you are naturally good at, the things that God has just skilled you in? And secondly, what are you supernaturally good at? What's your spiritual gifts? If you don't know them, can I encourage you, ask your life group leader if you're in a life group, or go under the door after the services and talk to Michelle or to John or one of the other community pastors and ask them, hey, how do I discover my spiritual gifts? There are tools out there that will help you discover how God spiritually wired you up and what gifts he gave you. Third question is, am I using God's gifts for the kingdom or only for me? Am I using his natural and supernatural gifts for the kingdom purposes? Am I engaged in the life of the kingdom, or am I just using them for my own benefit? This is a really important question to ask, because some of you, we know statistically that a large number of you here are not serving anywhere in the church. Now, you may be serving outside the church, which is great. But here's the thing, friends, this is not intended to be a guilt trip message at all. Okay, if you don't feel led to serve, then don't serve. But here's the thing. If you are not discovering how God wired you up, what he made you to do, and what your kingdom purpose is, in that he has a kingdom purpose for you, if you don't discover it and then step into it to serve both the body here at Bentry and then outside to serve the world as God sends us all on mission together, to see to it that no one misses the grace of God. If you are not stepping into that, if you're just a spectator sitting there in the seats and not actively engaged using your spiritual gift, you are missing out. You're missing out on the adventure of the kingdom. He has so much more for you. And you know what else? The kingdom is missing out. The kingdom is missing your piece and your part and your unique thumbprint. We need you. Okay, not because there's need, but because God has uniquely designed you and he desires and wants you to be a part of his adventure here at Bent Tree. That's the third question. So what am I naturally good at, supernaturally good at? Am I using God's gift for the kingdom or just for me? How does God want to use me to benefit the kingdom? If you don't know, pray. If you say, okay, I'm in, I want to get in, I want to be involved in kingdom work, what do? Ask him. And then listen, and then see how he prompts you by his Spirit. He will lead and he will guide you exactly where you need to be. The last thing is, what can I do to grow his gifts in me? What can I do to grow? What am I really good at? Am I good at science? Am I good at helping things, building things? Am I good at music? Am I good at leadership? What is it that you're really good at? And what can you do to grow? What can you do to grow? Kids, I want to ask you similar questions. There's three questions for you. What has God made you good at, like Avery wrote down here? How can you get better at it? What can you do to practice? Maybe it's piano, maybe it's school, whatever it might be. Maybe it's soccer. How can you get better at it? And then how can you use it for God? Ask him. Say, God, I don't know why you gave me this gift, but I'm going to get better at it. And can you show me what you want to do through this gift in my life? How can you use it? And he'll show you. The beautiful thing when I think about this is, what if our church here at Bentry really worked this way? What if every single one of us discovered, developed, and then used our spiritual gifts? This place would transform. We would see ministry pour out of this place as God empowers it by his Spirit and then does the things that are in his heart to do. We would see an incredible wave of ministry flow out of this place. And this place would continue to be healthy and grow. And friends, what a picture that would be. I want to encourage us in that and to do that. So, let me finish with this. I want to show you just a little thing. So I told you Kansas, like I couldn't sing Kansas. And it frustrated me to hear those guys and go, I will never do that. Well, lo and behold, when I started working on my voice, a couple of years later, I realized I'm actually starting to hit those notes that I never thought I could hit before. I did it so that I could be more useful for the kingdom. I wanted to be more useful in ministry and sing the things that were on my heart to be able to share with people who came to our services. That's why I did it. I didn't do it for any other reason. But sometimes when we develop our gifts and we use them, God blesses us in unexpected ways. So lo and behold, about 6 months before I came to Texas, we were doing a conference at Willow Creek, and the guest speaker was Kerry Livgren. Kerry Livgren is the guitar player and the chief songwriter for Kansas. He wrote Carry On Wayward Son, and he was coming to speak about his life in Christ. He had become a Christian several years before, was an elder in his church, was a brilliant guy, and was sharing his testimony. And as a result of that, they wanted him to come and play some of his most famous songs. So he was going to play Carry On Wayward Son, and they said, we need someone to sing it. Scott can do it. Like, no, I can't. Never sung that stuff in my life. And so we came to rehearsal, and I sang it, and it was rough. It was not good, and I'm thinking, oh, what am I going to do? Oh, thank God that I had worked on my gift because I knew what to do. I knew where the weaknesses in my voice were. So I went that night and I worked on it, and I kind of sang the song into my voice. And as I was able to sing it, and I'm going to actually show you a minute. This is not to show off, although it's really fun for me to watch this. This was like my favorite moment in all of my singing life, was this one moment here, and it's when I get to scream this really loud note that I couldn't have hit for the life of me when I was 17 or even 23. And Carrie Livgren's there doing his damn. So anyway, watch it, and I'll comment on it. Yeah. And at one point, he pointed to me and was like, "All right, way to go. You were really bad yesterday, but you actually hit it this time." I could, you know, it was like, "Jesus, take me now. I'm good." Right? It was such a fun moment. But the cool thing for me was, again, I had developed my voice so I could do that simply to build the kingdom, because I want to be useful in God's hand, and he turned and blessed me for it. But then later on, Vonda and I actually for the last 10 years or so have been able to travel around the country and around the world. We go about 8 times a year, and we go and we teach some of these techniques that were taught to me that unlocked my voice to other churches, to other church leaders, so that they can experience the same kind of freedom that I did and that Vonda did. And oh, God has birthed this ministry out of simply being faithful and desiring to take what he had already given me and grow it and develop it. Friends, if you do that, if you discover how God made you, what he made you good at, and the supernatural spiritual gifts that he gave you, if you will invest in them and pour into them and take pains with them, absorb yourself in getting better at them, and then give them to him for his kingdom purposes, you will be amazed at what he does in and through you. And that's my prayer for you. Would you stand and let's pray together? Father, what an amazing thing that you invite us in to the work and the adventure of your kingdom. Thank you that you give us gifts, that you made us good at something, maybe more than one thing. Thank you that you gave us spiritual gifts that you empower us to do by your Holy Spirit. And Lord, I pray that every single person here would discover what those are, would commit them to you, to use them for your kingdom purposes, and then would do everything they can to develop those gifts, to get better at them so that you can use them however it is that you want to. And I pray that you would blow their minds, that you would do things through them that are far beyond what anyone here could ask or imagine. And I pray that as a result of that, you would take this place, this body of Bentree, and you would send out a wave of love and compassion and ministry and meeting the needs of people that don't know you, Jesus. That you would literally use us as your body, playing our part, being a part of the kingdom. Lord, I pray that you would empower us by your Spirit to do that. We know that you will. We thank you for your promise. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your kingdom. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a great week. We'll see you next Sunday.